Hi there! In this tutorial, I'll show you how to create and animate a 3D tribal shape with a chrome effect using Adobe Illustrator, Blender, and After Effect for the animation. If you enjoyed this video, please subscribe and leave a like. It will motivate me to create and share other creations. We're going to import our tribal shape image into Illustrator to vectorize it. This allows us to rework it at will, so that it's no longer pixelated. This means it can be enlarged and used at any size. To do this, we click on our layer, and in the top left-hand corner, we click on Vectorize Image. This has just transformed our pixelated image into a vector shape. But in doing so, we've distorted our image. To correct and make up for the image destruction caused by vectorization, we'll open the following panel by clicking on this button. In the Image Vectorization panel, we can play with several parameters to transform our vectorization. First, we'll change the value of threshold. As you can see, we need to find a balance, otherwise we'll degrade our image too much. Next, we'll configure the tracings option, which adds or removes points from our vector shapes. This will indirectly vary the level of detail in our shape. The next option, angles, will make our angles more or less rounded. For this shape, we want a minimum in rounding, so I'm going to choose a value of 100%. The last parameter, noise, will generate small variations by adding deformations to our shape. We don't need it, so we'll keep it to a minimum. Not all these values need to be exactly the same. I advise you to set your own values, as this will necessarily depend on your shape and how you want it to look. Once we've finished setting up, we click on Decompose. This will convert our shape into vectors and apply the previous settings. As I want to have a symmetrical shape with the Rectangle tool, I'll draw a rectangle to cover the side of the shape I don't want to keep. I'll place it as close as possible to the center of the shape. Once positioned, I'll select all my shapes and open the Pathfinder panel. If you don't have it, go to Windows and click on Pathfinder. Once in Pathfinder, we'll select the Merge option to merge all superimposed shapes of the same color. Then I'll select my white rectangle and delete them. In this way, we've cut out half of our shape. Now we can select our shape and drag and drop it with Shift plus Alt plus left click to duplicate our shape in the same alignment as the first. We'll put it in the right direction by right clicking and selecting Mirror with the Vertical option. I'm going to bring our shape closer to the first one. To make our shape a single block, we'll select it in Pathfinder and use the Merge option. We've just finished vectorizing our shape. We'll now move on to the 3D part in Illustrator. To do this, select our shape and open the Dilatation option in Effect, then 3D and Materials. As we can see with this effect, if I rotate it on its Y axis, our shape is inflated on the front face. In the 3D and Materials panel, we'll check the Dilate Both Sides box, which will inflate the shape on both sides. You need to have the same parameters as I do, i.e. a depth of 3.5, a twist of 0 degrees, a taper of 100%, and a volume of 100%. With this option, we can directly add material to our shape by going to the Materials tab, but this isn't what we're interested in for our rendering. We'll leave the default material and export our vector shape. To do this, we'll open the File Export tab. If you don't have it on your desktop, you can find it in Window and File Export. Simply drag and drop your shape into the File Export tab. Then at the very bottom, there's an export panel where you can choose your export format. We'll choose the OBJ format. This is a 3D format readable by Blender. Then click on Export. Choose where you want to save your file. We'll need it to import it into Blender straight away. We'll open Blender and delete the default cube. We'll go to File, then Import, and select Wavefront.obj to find our file. Once imported, I'll set my camera to face our shape. Once positioned, I'll change the camera format to a square 2000px by 2000px. We'll open the Material Properties tab and change our display option to Viewport Shading, giving us the view of our final rendering. In the Material Properties tab, we'll change the base color to white, then increase the metallic value and reduce the roughness value. To get a better view of our material, we'll need to reposition our light. Once positioned, we'll go to the Shading tab and configure our object's reflection. First of all, we'll go to Render Properties, then Film, and check the Transparent box, which will erase our environment from our final rendering. We'll add nodes in the World tab to change our environment and work on our object's reflection. We'll click on Add, then Search, and add the following elements: texture coordinate, mapping, and image texture. You'll need to link them the same way I did. Then, in the Image Texture tab, we'll import the image that will be in the reflection of our object. For my part, I'm going to import an image of a galaxy. Once imported, we can move this image in the Mapping and Location tabs. Then we'll accentuate the brightness of our reflection by increasing the Strength value in the Background tab. We're going to add more light and light reflection to our shape. To do this, go to Render Properties and check the Ambient Occlusion, Bloom, and Motion Blur boxes. Then we're going to remodel our light. I'm going to change it to an area light and position it as I wish. With the chrome effect finished, we'll move on to animating our shape. We'll go to the Layout tab and, in the bottom right-hand corner, change the value of our timeline. I've set the first box to 0 and the second to 60, which is the number of frames we'll export. You can add more if you wish. Then we'll position our cursor at frame 0, and in the Objects Properties tab, we'll add a keyframe on the Z-axis at 0 degrees. Then we'll move our cursor to frame 60 and change the Z-axis value to 360 degrees. This will animate my object so that it makes two turns on itself. For a single turn, set the value to 180 degrees. Once this is done, we'll go to the panel and prepare to export our images. To do so, we'll use this configuration, select File Format in PNG if we want to have control over the background of our image, and choose the destination file for our export. Once validated, we'll go to the Render tab and click on Render Animation. Now all we have to do is wait for our 60 images to be generated. Once the rendering is complete, we'll move on to converting our animation into a video format. I'm going to use After Effect for this, but the principle remains the same, so you can do it with any editing software. Once in After Effect, right-click in the Project column and select Import and File. Then we'll find our folder with our images. We'll select all our images and check that the PNG sequence and Create Composition boxes are ticked, then validate the import. We can already see the rendering of our animation. If we want to increase the duration of our animation, we can do so by creating a new composition and then importing our animation into the sequence. I'll add a black solid to add a background. And simply duplicate the sequence of our animation and drag it to the end of the first one. This will create a loop. From here, you're free to choose the time of your sequence. You can also slow down or speed up your animation. You can also rework the rendering by adding an effect layer, and in Effects and Presets, add a brightness and contrast. To rework intensity, you can also add a hue and saturation effect. Once I'm satisfied, all that's left to do is export my animation in the video format of your choice. And here's our final rendering. If you have any questions, don't hesitate to ask them in the comment section. I'll be happy to answer or help. If you liked this video, please subscribe and leave a like. It will motivate me to create more tutorials of my creations. See you on the channel.